yesterday, in context of this Hindu marriage, we also touched this section 114 of the Indian Evidence Act regarding the presumption. And when the parties or two Hindus, male or female, represent themselves as husband and wife in a society, and they are so regarded by the society for a continuous long period, then presumption is in his favor that they are legally wedded husband and wife. Who says it? How can it be presumed? So I told you, with the help of section 114 of the Indian Evidence Act, we presume so. So now let us refresh the section 114 Evidence Act. The court may presume the existence of any fact which it thinks likely to have happened, regard being had to the common course of natural events, human conduct, and public and private business in their relation to the facts of a particular case. Apart from this language, some illustrations has been added to section 114. When court may presume, so first of all you must know what is the meaning of the may presume. May presume is a revocable presumption, is means if court is presuming something under the presumption of may presume, it can be rebutted by the other party. So may presume just initial, you can say the discharge, the initial burden of proving such a fact which is being presumed. But presumption is always rebutable unless it is a case of a conclusive presumption, where one fact is said to be conclusive proof of the other. This section talks of facts relating to the manner they happened, how the facts happened, and with having regard to the course of natural events, human conduct, and public and private business. So events have to be seen in a natural manner, keeping in mind the human conduct. So if having regard to these two aspects, common course of natural events and the human conduct, which is reflected by the conduct of these two Hindus, male, one male and another female, that they represent themselves before the society as husband and wife. So court, keeping in mind their behavior, their conduct, and also the natural course of action. Natural course of action, ki after marriage, husband and wife live together and share common roof. So in such circumstances, if the fact that they have lived like husband and wife, because nobody has seen them wedding, they actually wedded or not, it has not been known. But what is seen, what is visible from their conduct, is that they are behaving like husband and wife. So if this fact, these facts are proved that they are living in one residence, they represent themselves as husband and wife before the society, society regards them and this period is for a long time, then court may presume that they have married and they are husband and legally wedded husband and the wife. So this is how section 114 comes into play and help the court and the other persons in forming a presumption, in raising a presumption, though a weak presumption in nature of may presume, which is rebuttable, but initially if law presumes something, so person proving marriage is initially discharged of proving the factum of the marriage, if he is able to prove the other facts regarding the conduct and human behavior of these two couple or persons. Not only this section 114, the matter also came before Honorable Supreme Court for consideration. And in Tulsa versus Durghatia, something South Indian, I think, Durghatia, 2008, SCC 520. Honorable Supreme Court held there would be a presumption in favor of bad luck if the partners live together for long spell as husband and wife, but it would be a rebuttable and heavy burden lies on the person who seeks to deprive the relationship of legal origin to prove that no marriage took place. So with the help of the section 114 Evidence Act and the interpretation of this section by Honorable Supreme Court in the above Tulsa versus Durghatia's case in 2008 makes the picture clear that presumption is in favor of a wedlock provided the other conditions are fulfilled. After this presumption of wedlock or marriage, we discuss this registration of the Hindu marriage under section 8 and how the extracts or entries in the register can be used as an evidence for proving the factum of marriage in a prospective litigation. Now you can see the marriages between two Hindus may fall down, a marriage between two Hindus may fall down under three heads. It's a perfect valid marriage, it may be a void marriage, it may be a voidable marriage. So you can say the marriages can be classified under three heads: void marriages, voidable marriages and the perfect marriages. Void and voidability, again this question has arisen in this act. I will take you back to the Contract Act where you studied the relationship between void and voidability. Just reminding you again, a void agreement or a void contract is void from its inception. It is like non-est in eyes of law, never existed. A voidable contract is a perfect contract. Voidability is directly related to the consent of the parties. If the consent of the contracting party was not freely given, then the contract act says that such contract would be voidable at the option of the party whose consent was so caused. So where the consent was not freely given, law provided an opportunity and remedy to such party to get such contract declared as void. So a voidable contract is a perfect contract unless challenged by the concerned party. The challenge can only be made by the party whose consent was not freely given. And if such a contract is challenged in a court of law with a prayer to declare it as void, and court declares it void, then it has a retrospective effect, and this voidable contract is declared void from its inception. It is again same as in case of void contract. It is a void from its inception and non-est in the eyes of law. If a voidable contract is not challenged, there can be no question of declaring it void by a court of law. Therefore, such a voidable contract will be a perfect contract. On the same analogy, the theory of void and voidability has been applied to the marriages here under Hindu Marriage Act. If you visualize the section 5, essentials of a Hindu marriage, there are 5 grounds or 5 conditions for a valid Hindu marriage. Reminding you again, not having any spouse living, number 1. Number 2, consent, capable of giving a valid consent. Number 3 is the age, and number 4 is the prohibited degrees relationship, and 5th one is the sapindas relationship. Section 12 of the Hindu Marriage Act talks of voidable marriages, and section 11 talks of void marriages. And section 11 declares marriage void which have been solemnized in contravention of clause 1, 4th and 5th. What are these 3? First is the having a spouse. Either spouse should not have already have a spouse living at the time of marriage. If such is the case, the marriage is void. Despite the proper solemnization of the marriage. And if the parties to the marriage are within prohibited degrees, the marriage is void. And if the parties to the marriage are sapindas of each other, the marriage is void. So on these 3 grounds, 1st, 4th and 5th of section 5, what would be the result? Marriage is void. we talked of second ground, that was the age, contravention of the age clause 21 and 18 for groom and bridegroom respectively. And it is a child marriage in view of provisions under prohibition of the Child Marriage Act. Such marriage is a voidable marriage. So now come to the section 12, voidable marriage, which marriage will be a voidable marriage. So number one would be the age clause contravention. Contravention of the age clause means where any of the parties to the marriage has contravented or not completed the age of the 21 or the 18 as the case may require. So this is second, and third clause is the age. So on ground of the first clause, it is a void marriage. On ground of the consent, it is a voidable marriage. On ground of age, it is a voidable marriage. On ground of the prohibited degrees or the suppindas relationship, fourth and fifth, it is a void marriage. So on two ground it is voidable. Number one, consent ground, and number two, age ground. So out of these five grounds, on three grounds the marriage is void, and for rest of the two grounds, two clauses, there is the second and the third, contravention of the age or contravention of the free consent clause, the marriage is voidable. One more distinction between void and voidable. A void marriage is a nullity. A void marriage is void ab initio, and I told you it is non-est in the eyes of law, and there is no need to declare it void. It is void in itself. So void marriage will be void from its inception, and voidable marriage will be a perfect marriage unless it is challenged and declared by court. So